All right, we are in Matthew chapter 4. We are in this discussion of temptation. And in Matthew chapter 4, Jesus is in the wilderness. This is before he starts his ministry. He has been baptized by John. He is led into the wilderness by the Spirit, and there he is for 40 days and 40 nights. And Satan is there, that as we see that verse 1, then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. So he is going to be there alone, except Satan is going to be there. Now, I do want to make this point, because in this text, we have three ways in which Satan is, three things Satan is called. He's called the tempter. First, in verse 1, he's called the devil. Verse 3, he's called the tempter. Verse 5, he's called the devil again. Verse 8, he's called the devil again. And then in verse 10, Jesus says, "Away with you, Satan." So we have different ways in which different things Satan is called. So if we were wondering, okay, which devil, which tempter, who is this exactly? Well, come verse 10, we know precisely who it is. That there are many unclean spirits, there are many devils. But when the Bible refers to the devil, we know that it is Satan. And of course, Satan, the name Satan means adversary, which is precisely what he is. And Jesus is being tested here, and it's him and Satan. And in this, we see with the first temptation, it just had to do with physical need. All right, you have been here and you haven't eaten anything for 40 days. It's time to eat. Command these stones become bread. If you're the Son of God, you know, you do it. You have that. Then Jesus quotes Deuteronomy 8 and 3 to, in all this, Jesus is showing us how to use Scripture, what we can do to use Scripture. Appropriate use. So he quotes Deuteronomy 8 in verse 3, all right, and so the devil sees, all right, that was of no use. I couldn't tempt him there. He's going to Scripture to prove he cannot do what I've been tempting him to do. So then the devil does take him bodily. There's no other way to look at this. The devil takes him physically to the pinnacle of the temple, and then quotes Psalm 91, 11 and 12 to say, if you're the Son of God, throw yourself off the temple, throw yourself off the pinnacle of this temple, because God will surely protect you. If you're the Son of God, that's precisely what he's going to do, because Psalm 91, 11 and 12 say that. Now, as we have made mention, we read Psalm 91 last week, and he does quote it. He's not adding anything to it, but it is misapplication. And what Jesus does is use Deuteronomy 6:16 to show it's a misapplication. Now, we didn't do this last week, but I want to do it now to show that misapplications are done all the time. We spoke, I do believe, last week, but I could be wrong. My lessons all get kind of fuzzy, all joining together. But let's go to 2 Peter and 2 Peter chapter 3. And we just look at this at verse 15. And consider that the longsuffering of our Lord is salvation, as also our beloved brother Paul, according to the wisdom given to him, has written to you, as also in all his epistles, speaking in them of things in which are some things hard to understand, which untaught and unstable people twist to their own destruction, as they do also the rest of Scripture. You have untaught and unstable people. What they will do is misapply Scripture. They will twist it to their own destruction. The scripture, any given scripture has a meaning. It doesn't have multiple options of it can mean this or it can mean that, or it can mean that, or it can mean that, or it can mean, it means all of it. It doesn't, or I should say, and it means. It means this, and it means that, and it means this, the other, and it means the other. It only has one interpretation, only one way of looking at any particular verse as the correct way. We can be off, but there's, and regardless of what man does, God intended on any given thing that he said to have one meaning, not multiple meanings and contradictory meanings. He never does that. But we see 2 Peter chapter 3 that Peter writes that Paul has written some things hard to understand, and we'll repeat this. Peter doesn't say he didn't understand it or that it couldn't be understood, but there are some things harder to understand than other things, which is just a natural way things are. Some things are going to be easier, some things are going to be harder. But notice, it's the hard things that untaught and unstable people twist to their own destruction because they don't really go to the simple, because the simple will show them in more direct language, this is the meaning of it. This is the meaning. Whereas they go to more difficult passages and then try to extrapolate, try to get a meaning from it while ignoring the simpler, go straight to the complex, go straight there and try to get a meaning that they want it to say. That's exactly what Satan does with Psalm 91. Instead of doing what Jesus did of looking at Deuteronomy 6 and 16 and using that, if you're the Son of God, all right, how well would this work? Of course, none of it worked, but how well would this work? If you're
Thank you. Thank you.
Now, Jesus saying, away with you, Satan. It's written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve. Verse 11, then the devil left him. All right. Devil has not succeeded. He does leave him. And behold, angels came and ministered to him. Angels did not come and minister him to him while he was being tempted. They weren't there. They didn't do that while he was there. But they are ministering to him because he's in the middle of the wilderness and he hasn't eaten. Now, did they feed him? Well, he could not do miracles for his own benefit, but that's not to say that God couldn't do it, that the Father couldn't do it. And here, there is an utter failure by Satan, and Satan's going to see more failure on his part. Satan's going to continue to fail, and there is going to be nothing but victory for Christ. Here is this failure, and here is this victor. And one is the devil who leaves him because he tried. He gave it his best shot, and nothing worked. Now he leaves him, and angels come and minister to Jesus. But does this mean that Satan will not tempt him ever again? Well, I think that he does try to do that. If we go to Matthew chapter 16, we're going to see a man by the name of Peter. Peter is one who he can say something, and there's nothing so unique about Peter that you don't find this in yourself or just common. But Peter can say something absolutely straight on faith, that you have it precisely. You have come to the proper conclusion, and then turn around and say something that is just faithless. That you're saying something you don't even know what you're saying. But like in verse 16, so Matthew 16, verse 16, Jesus says, ask the question, verse 15, but who do you say that I am? Verse 16, Simon Peter answered and said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus answered and said to him, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. All right, so here is, that's correct. And notice that flesh and blood didn't reveal this, but my Father in heaven revealed it. Now, we come to verse 21. From that time, Jesus began to show to his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and be raised the third day. Then Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, far be it from you, Lord, this shall not happen to you. Now, is that by faith? Because what Jesus just said, what Jesus gave in verses 21, well, in verse 21, is prophecy. And it's a fulfillment of prophecy. Jesus is saying it's going to happen, but others said it was going to happen as well. This has been set before earth began. And Jesus responds to this rebuke, far be it from you, Lord, this shall not happen to you. Jesus responds, but he turned and said to Peter, get behind me, Satan. You are an offense to me, for you are not mindful of the things of God, but of the things of man. That is a complete turnaround from what Jesus just said concerning Peter, because what Peter said is so different. That he says, you're the Christ, Son of the living God. Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah. Flesh and blood's not revealed this to you, but my Father who's in heaven. Now, Peter said, no, this is not going to happen to you. And then Jesus said, get behind me, Satan. You're an offense that you're mindful of the things of man, not of the things of God. Now, was this truly a temptation? And I think, of course it was a temptation. This was very much a temptation. especially since we have written for us, and it wasn't too long ago that we were reading this in the book of Mark and the other Gospels as well, of where he's in the Garden of Gethsemane and he's praying to the Father, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me, meaning the crucifixion, the trial, the scourging, all the public display, the humiliation, the grief, everything, the pain, everything associated with it. If this cup can pass from me, then, you know, let that be done. But your will is to be done. And he is sweating. He is profoundly sweating. He is there in the garden with great anguish, is the word. And you think that this wouldn't be a temptation of, oh, far be it from you, Lord, this shall not happen to you, as a rebuke. This will not happen to you. Well, he said he could bring down 12 legions of angels if he wanted to. He could do it if that's what he wanted to do. And was this attempt, and if Peter had gotten his way, well, then everything would have been hopeless. There would be nothing but doom for all mankind. Nothing but. We would not have a Savior at all. But, all right. Well, I appreciate everyone being here with us. And we need to close up for this morning. And hopefully we can begin again next week. Thank you, everybody.